الله أكبر الله أكبر.
Here we are in Istanbul, happy to be together again. In the shadow of cascading domes and minarets of the Blue Mosque, we are ready and excited to begin our next new adventure. We are discovering Ottoman Empire and its colorful storybook history, first in Hagia Sophia, which began as a Roman church, converted to a mosque in 15th century, and then declared a museum in 1935 by the first president of Turkey, Mehmet Atatürk. The original structure is unmistakably Roman. Heavy, solid arches, columns, and magnificent main dome. The original mosaics from 9th through 11th century are located in the apse and upper gallery. They are very well preserved because for centuries, while the structure was being used as a mosque, they had been covered over with stucco. In the huge main nave, there are more partially preserved Byzantine mosaics and also gigantic 19th century medallions inscribed with gilt Arabic letters, reminders that for several centuries Hagia Sophia was used as a mosque. Decorative motifs are also undoubtedly Arabic. No, the morning is not cold or very windy. It's the ladies preparing to enter the Blue Mosque. Gentlemen are checking their socks. They don't want to be embarrassed by unexpected holes. To enter the mosque and pray to Allah, you need to have innocent soul, pure thoughts, and clean feet. What a magnificent carpet! No wonder you need to have clean feet. The ornate decor of the interior is predominantly in blue Isnik tiles, hence the unofficial name Blue Mosque. It was a grand project of Sultan Ahmed in the 17th century. Lofty heights of the domes and perfect proportions of the building confirm the truth about the greatness and perfection of God. When in doubt, or perhaps lost, tourists should look for help to security. Please memorize the word, best through association, or repeat after me. Guvenlink, Guvenlink, Guven. Süleymaniye Mosque stands on a hill dominating the city since the mid-16th century and offering lovely views of the Golden Horn. Its construction was a pet project of Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent. Inside, barefoot and bound in our headscarves, we wander through the vast and empty structure. It is meant to be filled with praying faithful, but only a few of them are present. Separated from the tourists by a wooden divider, they are kneeling facing Mecca. Mimar Sinan was the architect who perfected the design of the classical Ottoman mosque. Large central dome, domed arcades, striped arches, and colorful, intricate decorative designs are hallmarks of all his projects. Mihrimah Mosque is another Sinan masterpiece dating back to 16th century. It was commissioned by Sultan's favorite daughter. Light and airy interior features delicate stained glass windows and unusual birdcage chandelier. Walking distance from the Mihrimah Mosque is one of the most stunning Byzantine monuments in the city. Unfortunately, the main part of the Kora Church was closed for renovations. We were only able to visit the Chapel of Tombs and the antechamber leading to the main nave. All mosaics and frescoes in these rooms date back to the beginning of the 14th century. The chapel is decorated with frescoes that deal with themes of death and resurrection and illustrate scenes from Old Testament. Yes, we are all worn out and need a rest. And maybe even lunch. Energy replenished, we are ready to tackle the Grand Bazaar, the sprawling labyrinth that is the heart of the old city. It's been here for over 500 years. First, we will stop at the jewelry stores, and then, hold on, everyone wants to go in different direction. Pashmina shawls come with instructions how to wear them. Watch carefully. Our eyes are dancing, the dizzying arrays of patterns, colors.
Whoops! The wardrobe malfunction!
We're trying to keep together in this flowing river of humanity, but every second our eyes dart left and right, taking in something fascinating and new. Next, the Spice Bazaar, Ottoman era market of colorful exotic spices and Turkish delights. This used to be the last stop for caravans traveling the Silk Road. This is Hürrem Sultan Hamami. Are you up for a quintessential Turkish experience? Pampering enjoyed by sultans? Here are the oldest Turkish baths in the city, newly refurbished, and Vitek is curious. Are the baths co-educational, he asks? Of course not. Ladies on the right, gentlemen on the left. Too bad. Hippodrome was a Byzantine invention. Emperors liked nothing better than an afternoon at the races. Chariot races, that is. After Byzantium, the Great Plaza served for centuries as city's meeting place. So here we are. Topkapi Palace is a place of many legends and romantic imaginings. It was a home of the sultans of Ottoman Empire and their courts for hundreds of years. Its size and opulence appealed to the imagination. Sprawling pavilions, jewel-packed treasury, and a vast harem were all once filled with people and teeming with life. Richly and intricately decorated, Topkapi was Ottoman Empire's Versailles. Do not be envious of sultans. They usually had a short and stressful life. Just imagine keeping 4 wives, 100 or more concubines, and your own mother at bay. Then all the children. Sultan Murad III had 112 of them. And then all the relatives and functionaries, everyone vying for Sultan's attention and appealing to his generosity. He needed many rooms to hide in. Walls of this room probably witnessed more political intrigues, murderous plots, and romantic secrets than you would care to imagine. this courtyard inside the harem, on a second floor behind the shuttered windows, Sultan brothers were often kept in isolation to prevent them from plotting to overthrow him. Believe it or not, these columns and lights are reflected in water. We are in a vast underground tank built by Emperor Justinian in 532 AD to hold water for the city in case of siege. There are 336 marble columns supporting the cistern. Some of them have carved bases, as these three carvings representing Medusa's head. The scale of this structure is mind-boggling. And so is the sight of Vitek dressed up as a sultan. Galata Bridge crosses Golden Horn to Beyoğlu, the European part of the city. This part of Istanbul is dominated by the Galata Tower, built in 1348. The upper balcony of the tower offers magnificent views of the Bosphorus, Golden Horn, and the city. Beyoğlu, the European quarter is going through a renaissance of sorts. It has become bohemian, with rows of art galleries, outdoor cafes, boutiques, and trendy restaurants. Lunch at one of the popular Beyoğlu hangouts was truly delicious. After lunch, a boat takes us along the banks of European side of Bosphorus. We are cruising under the bridges connecting Europe and Asia. Sultan's Rococo residence from 1856, Dolma Bassi Palace, a lot more modern than Topkapi. It's fitted with gas lighting and water closets from England. In the city like Istanbul, history and modernity exist side by side. This early medieval fort next to a suspension bridge. These are our last views of Istanbul on the Asian side, luxurious waterfront residential area. The following leg of our journey takes us by plane to Kayseri, the largest city in Cappadocia. From here on our way to Göreme, we stop at the local vegetable market. Everything looks fresh, colorful, and tempting. This radish is the size of a baking potato. Thank you. From vegetables, we shift to rock formations. After all, the landscape is what Cappadocia is famous for. The landscape is indeed spectacular, taken straight from science fiction. Surreal. Tuff is a soft rock made of compressed volcanic ash. It is pliant material, easily carved or eroded. People who inhabited the area took advantage of it and made their homes in the rock pillars or underground. Many tribes traveled through these valleys. Thousands of years passed. Numerous civilizations rose and fell and left traces of their existence buried in the volcanic ash. The valleys of Cappadocia are a treasure trove of historical relics. Yannick is always testing limits of warning signs. No hiking beyond this point. These formations are known as fairy chimneys. The core is hard basalt rock, surrounded by compressed ash, which is in the process of eroding. Our private name for these rocks was Turkish phalluses with French berets. Another example of spectacular erosion. Anyone for an ice cream cone? Here, we could not complain for a lack of lighting effects. This tree is leaning under the weight of Turkish evil eyes, popular blue glass charms which are believed to keep evil spirits away. Shopping and trying on variety of local head covers. some of them very exotic and alluring. On this crisp morning, we are visiting the underground city of Kaimakli. It is thought to have been originally carved by Hittites and was mentioned by Greeks in 4th century BC. Almost 1,000 years later, it was utilized by Byzantine Christians to escape persecution from Romans, Persians, and Arabs. There are many sites such as this one in Cappadocia. This particular one is 8 levels deep and probably housed about 3,000 people. Dining at a restaurant located in an abandoned, quote-unquote, house that used to belong to a Greek family. By abandonment, the Turks mean forcible exchange of minority populations between Turkey and Greece that took place in 1922. The political expediencies notwithstanding, restaurant food was very good. At our next stop, Göreme Open Air Museum, the extraordinary backdrop called for a group photo. This museum is an essential stop on a tour of Cappadocia. It is a World Heritage Site, an important Byzantine monastic settlement, and from 17th century, a pilgrimage site. Most remarkable, of course, are the rock-cut churches, chapels, and monastic quarters. They are carved deep into the perpendicular walls and are accessible by worn-out steps, also carved into the rock, or more recent and safer metal staircases. The walls outside and inside of these chambers are decorated with very fine frescoes of saints, lives of saints, biblical scenes, as well as portraits of church financiers, architects, and important monks. The frescoes date back from anywhere between 8th and 13th century. Admission to Göreme Open Air Museum is not cheap. But the effort of Turkish government to organize and control tourism at sites like these and renovate and preserve the artwork is well worth the price of a ticket. We all agreed while drinking delicious Turkish tea and eating local snacks. And finally, Turkish carpets. Here we visit Carpet Workshop. The industry is strictly regulated by the government. Women who weave these masterpieces are artists allowed to work only limited time during the week and have to be of certain age. In other words, no more child labor and extended hours. Carpet making tradition in Turkey is at least 2,000 years old. Turkish carpets are double knotted and are either made of wool or silk. Patterns differ from region to region, but some elements in local designs can be traced back to Persian and Chinese carpets. Sampling local specialties. And next morning, a hike along the river flowing through the Pigeon Valley. Early Christians used to farm fertile plots at the bottom of this valley. They lived and worshipped in caves carved into the soft canyon walls. They also raised pigeons in abandoned caves. Many more fantastic sights and adventures were still awaiting us further down the road. Fording a river was not in our plans. Some of us got very wet so that others could remain dry. Thank you. finally a well-deserved rest in our warm, watertight, and comfortable van. The town of Avanos, at the banks of Kizirmak, which means Red River, has been known for centuries for its pottery. Red clay from the river and white mountain mud provide the raw materials. The tradition of pot making, which came from local Hittite tribes, continues today using the same shapes, patterns, and colors as hundreds of years ago. Every detail done painstakingly by hand. On our way to the abandoned village of Zelve, we stop to take in this spectacular landscape. The inhabitants of Zelve were resettled to a new location in 1952. The village continuously functioned as a settlement since 9th century, when it was first established as a monastic retreat. Because of erosion and rockfalls, living in the cave houses and climbing the walls has been declared dangerous for the inhabitants. Today, many areas are still cordoned off and inaccessible to visitors. From Cappadocia in central Turkey, we are moving west to explore Turkish Mediterranean coastline. The area of Kusadasi is rich with relics of ancient Greek, Roman, and Christian civilizations. We first visit a small mountain house next to the sacred stream. It is believed to be the house to which St. John brought Virgin Mary near the end of her life, and where she subsequently died. Enterprising Turks erected a chapel on the house foundation. The foundation has been determined to be older than 6th century AD. They also sell a sacred water from the close by stream. Vatican has no official position as to the authenticity of the location. However, several popes have paid visits. In Selsuk, a sleepy provincial town within minutes from Ephesus, we pay a visit to the excavated ruins of St. John Basilica. St. John came to Ephesus twice. During his second stay, he penned his gospel on this very hill. The site inspired Emperor Justinian to build a monumental church next to the already existing fortress. The fortress itself dates back to the original ancient Greek settlement in Ephesus. The views from the top of the hill where the basilica once stood are excellent. Thank you. The city of Ephesus was once upon a time only second to Rome. You have to keep in mind that only 18% of the city has been excavated, and still you can easily feel disoriented meandering through its ruins. Passing through Upper Agora by the Odeon, which used to be the center of city's political life, we come across excavated sections of water and sewer pipes. We are heading towards ruins of the town hall, city treasury, and hospital. In its time, Ephesus was famous for its medical school. This is Curate's Way, Ephesus' main thoroughfare. Once it was lined with shops, statuary, and great buildings. The street is still paved with the original slabs of marble, which were gouged and grooved to prevent pedestrians from slipping when the street was wet. Curate's Way eventually leads to the Lower Agora, bypassing ruins of several interesting structures. One of them is Library of Celsus, third largest in an ancient world. It housed a collection of 12,000 scrolls, guarding them from extreme weather and vandals. It was built in the 2nd century AD. Across from the library entrance are the remains of the city's entertainment center, which consisted of public bath and a brothel. Some say that there was once an underground tunnel connecting the library and the house of ill repute. Located in the city center are public latrines, where all aspects of the experience were really public. One could continue to debate while sitting on a marble throne right next to one's adversary. These two arches used to be a part of the Temple of Hadrian, second most famous attraction in Ephesus after the library. Built in a Corinthian style, the first arch adorned by Tyche, the goddess of chance, while Medusa keeps evil spirits away on the second. Across Hadrian's temple, on the terraced side of the hill, there are ongoing excavations of private Roman residences. Seven well-preserved homes have been so far uncovered. There is no doubt that the rich of Ephesus lived on the side of this hill, looking down upon their city. Dwellings that have been so far excavated come from the 3rd century AD and used to be remarkably equipped with running hot and cold water baths. Rooms delightfully decorated with colorful frescoes, mosaics, and marble provide insight into luxurious living of Ephesus aristocracy. On the way to the Greek Theater, we pass through Lower Agora, former textile and food market that was once surrounded by a great colonnade. Originally built by ancient Greeks, this theater was reconstructed by Romans in the 1st century AD to accommodate 25,000 spectators. It is estimated that the population of Ephesus at that time was 250,000 people, not including these two. We are sailing south from Kusadasi along the Turkish Mediterranean coast to the city of Bodrum, one of Turkey's popular vacation destinations. Bodrum really has everything that makes a perfect vacation. Sun, sea, and sand, beautiful vistas, good restaurants, and even few historical sites, in case you get bored with beach life and craved more intellectual diversions. Here's one, the Castle of St. Peter, built by the Order of Knights Hospitaller in 1437. After passing to the Ottoman Empire and later to Turkish Republic, the castle today houses the Museum of Underwater Archaeology. This museum proudly holds all the ancient refuse that Turkish archaeologists were able to find in the Mediterranean waters around Bodrum. And there's plenty of it. Antiquities from Greece and Rome are mixed with ancient artifacts imported from Egypt, Syria, and the coast of Black Sea. Gullets were Turkish flat-bottom boats used to transport olive and oranges to ancient ports throughout Aegean Sea. This one sunk in 1025 AD and was reconstructed from what had been found on the bottom of the Salamakis Bay. The museum also has an impressive amphora collection. Some pieces date back to 14th century BC. The collection of artifacts here is somewhat haphazardly assembled, but the views from the castle walls are truly magnificent. Our whirlwind journey through Turkey ends appropriately at the ritual whirling dervishes ceremony. For whirling dervishes, it is a spiritual journey when their souls attain unity with God. For us, it is a final dose of Turkish food and folklore that is meant to stay with us for years to come. Thank you.
Thank you.